Okay, so I have gone off and I have done, oh, I should explain who I am first, sorry. A lot of people here will know me. I have been actually involved with Boost, incidentally, since about 2002, 2003, but you never saw me. My friend was Dave Abrams, so that's how my connection was. And he used to come along and pester me for code for Boost, and I used to keep telling him no, and he would then go off and make me. So, yeah, bits of mine came in under his user handle for quite some period of time, and what happened was that I ended up selling out to the corporate beast by joining BlackBerry back in 2012, and part of my responsibilities there was to participate more in open source libraries. So I signed up to Boost Dev for the very first time, and since then I think I did a ranking of postings to see who was the most frequent poster, and I came in at something like number three over the last 2 years, and even I was shocked at how many emails I've sent. So I mostly spend my time irritating people and annoying them and boring them. So anyway, as part of that, I came up with the idea of having a look at the C++ 11.14 libraries. And I thought that there are some interesting patterns which may be of interest to other people. I'll be blunt. I obviously have a certain position on where Boost 2.0 goes. That was based earlier on, it was based on a set of desires, a set of beliefs. I wanted to see if I was right. Needless to say, I will probably show that I think I'm right from the evidence. Admittedly, a lot of it does come down to opinion, though. So it comes down to interpretation. You may have seen a mailing list thread on Boost Dev yesterday. And that it's all interpretation. It's how do you weigh things? And I have weighed them my way. Other people would look exactly the same evidence and weigh them completely differently. So we'll see what happens. Here's going to be the talk overview. I'm going to firstly explain why I looked at some libraries and not others, because the accusation is, you know, why did I choose this 10? Because they support my view. No, it's a bit more comprehensive than that. And I'll have a grid next, which shows that how I ranked and scored them. You might notice that numbers, let's try this for the very first time, go 5, 4, 3, 2. The reason why is because I am going to do it backwards going up to the front. And the reason why is because I think this library is probably the most interesting of the lot. And that is where I'm very much pitching my view of things. I then jump on to the big picture answers. So what I was expecting was that we will almost certainly have some discussion arising during this one. I can see it already. And what I will do is I'll try to get as far in as I can. And when I do, I'll probably jump out at some point because I want to get to the end part in the last sort of, you know, half hour, and then leave 15 minutes or so. So what may happen, unfortunately, is we may end up pushing DL, which is terrible because it's a lovely library. If anyone wants to go see how you should do a brand new Boost library, I really have to recommend DL. It's just beautifully put together. The guy has got such attention to detail. He's actually unknown as well within the community relatively recently. So he did a great job at knocking the ball out of the park, in my opinion. But I mean, you'll see later on, I've done a handbook up of best practices, and I quote him a lot because he's got lots of lovely code. I just point into it and say, you know, you should do this. And in fact, I learned stuff looking at his library, and I was going, wow, you know, great. So just because I don't cover it doesn't mean you shouldn't go look at it, is what I'm saying. But we'll try and jump in and get to the end, and then hopefully we'll have some interesting discussion. So I actually looked at a total of 15 libraries. This list is, as far as I'm aware, the complete list of C++ 11/14 requiring libraries that may or may not enter Boost sometime soon. I got this list by going onto Boost Dev in March or April, and I said, everybody, what libraries are coming? And a whole list came back, and it came out with this sort of 15 items. Now, you might notice I've got little stars next to some of them. The little stars are how much I looked into the list. That one's written by me, so it gets 4 stars, because I would probably know my own thing relatively well. This is also written by me, so it also gets 4 stars. Expected has a bit of code in me, because I ported it to Visual Studio 2013, and I know reasonably well how that works. Fiber has a lot of input in. I don't know, Oliver may disagree. But the point is, I study that in detail too. HTTP was one of the GSOC projects that came through. So I had because I'm GSOC administrator for Boost, so I spent quite a bit of time looking at that. HANA, which of course is from Louis at the back. The reason it only has 1 star is not for a lack of me looking at it. It's because I really don't understand what Louis is writing, because it's just way above my head. I'm just not that good, to be honest. So that sort of breaks out why the stars are the way they are. So that's all relative. If I make sweeping statements about, say, HANA, I'm almost certainly wrong, because I really don't get it. Sorry, yes?
Sorry, I think you have to interrupt. Is there a champion or chat here? Has anybody seen him after the keynote? Okay, he's a speaker and he's missing. So if anybody sees him.
Okay, no problem.
Just one sec.
All good? Everyone good?
Yeah, good.
Good, okay. So how close are these libraries that I listed out of the 15? How close are these entering Boost? And to discern this, I went off and I built this lovely matrix. So just to make it easy for everybody, I've color-coded it. So green is good, red is bad, as a general rule. Over here is the name of the library in question. There's 10 of these in total. Here are the authors. The ones in orange, by the way, came out of Google Summer of Code program. So I'm really pleased that, you know, three of these have had an effect already. Over here is the minimum C++ level required. Here are the header dependencies. You'll notice none, 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 as in no dependencies on Boost headers whatsoever. Oliver is in the process at the minute of eliminating config from Fiber. And obviously, context is his own library, so he's not going to eliminate that, but he's going to break it off such that it's separate from Boost as well. And then it will be completely independent from all Boost headers. The only one that's really remaining is HTTP, and that does have a whole load of dependencies on Boost. However, Bjorn, who will be the review manager, has certainly mentioned that it's something they'll be looking at as whether to break that off and make it completely independent of Boost as well. So this is interesting. When did these things enter the peer review queue? Why am I using my hand when I have a pointer? You notice that Fiber went through some months ago, but what's happened is Oliver's gone off and pretty much rewritten the code out of 98 and into 14, actually. So it now is entirely a 14 code base that can't even run on Visual Studio anymore because it uses so much 14 features. On the other hand, it's conditionally accepted, so when it comes back for review, you know, it may well be the first library to enter. AFIO, which is my own, it entered into the queue in October 2013. I think it was the very first C++ 11 library to do so, and it has languished there for the lack of a review manager since. DI came in, so dependency injection this year. HANA and, of course, HTTP. Expected needs a whole lot of documentation. You'll see there is very little in the way of documentation over there, which is why it's really holding it back from entering into review. Someone has to sit down and do all of that. It'd be a lot of work, I would imagine. Over here is Boost Ready source code. That's entirely a set of, I went through the naming conventions. Did it look like a Boost library when you first looked at it? Did the structure have, you know, whatever it was there? The reason why, by the way, Paul Fultz says I left that out is because his macros didn't have a Boost prefix and he is not in the Boost namespace. Now, the Boost namespace part, I don't really care about. It could be in any namespace, but I think your macros do need to be prefixed probably by Boost if it's going to be a Boost library, maybe. So that's a bit, you know, not sure. Fair enough. Unit testing was interesting. You'll notice that these two, the ones using Boost Test, so they're kind of pretty clearly a one. These two have excellent unit tests, but they don't use Boost Test, which is interesting. So HANA, for example, as Louis knows, uses a lot of assert and a static assert, which there's nothing wrong with that. It's certainly for a metaprogramming library, you can see why static assert is so important. Beeman?
Why did you feel that a library isn't there's no requirement that you have to use Boost Test. Many of our most important libraries don't use Boost Test.
Absolutely. The question was, why did I feel it was important that a library should use Boost Test when many of the libraries don't use Boost Test, which is absolutely correct. The reason why I felt the use of Boost Test is important is, this is an argument I've had with a few of the library authors. I think it is easier for the release managers when you have a nice matrix of which tests pass and which tests fail that get put out by XML. I don't think you have to use Boost Test for that, but I think you need to have something that generates XML which goes into a nice matrix and says, you know, this particular test is failing but all these other tests are not.
Oh, so if you use a Boost lightweight test, you're still qualified?
Yes, so the question was, if you're using Boost lightweight test, would I still qualify that as being good? I would say that that's not as good, but I would still qualify it as being good. So what you're looking for is something that helps the release managers, you know, because all you get is a pass or fail, you see, and you don't want just pass or fail, you want detail, you know, because maybe it's something small, maybe it's something to be delegated. So I was being very strict, that's all.
Did you ask why people didn't use Boost Test?
The question is, did I ask why people didn't use Boost Test? I indeed did. The general response that came back is that boost test smells a bit funny. And I should qualify what I mean by that because people who aren't familiar. Boost test master branch, I think, hasn't really been updated. Is it in 5 years now? Is that correct? Something like 5 years. It has languished. There's a lot of known bugs in it. The develop branch has been pushing on and on and on and on with a whole load of new features. But it's unstable. It's not really usable in a production environment, in my opinion. Others would disagree. It's got problems on Visual Studio, I think, is the big showstopper for a lot of people. So what's happened is that boost test has become further and further away from being maintained, ultimately. I'm sure that will be repaired at some point in the future, but we're at where we are now. A lot of people look at boost test and go, it's this big, heavy, overcomplicated thing. There's lots of new C++ unit testing libraries now available, which don't have the limitations that boost tests do. I mean, Google test is a classic one, and it is very well maintained. Catch is another good example. It's all header only. You simply put it in, use it. It's beautiful. It prints pretty colored unit test output and console output. You can get it to output to Jenkins via JUnit. It's got all the features that most people need without all the heavyweight compile time, overheads, and everything else. A lot of people still use like assert, you know. There's actually nothing wrong with assert, static assert for your use case when you're the person looking at the debug output. I think it's more of a release issue that it's a lot easier for people using your library to see this test fails and this test pass at a very granular level. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
So then,
sorry?
You raised the question why you think it's important to have it used. I mean, you require to use a boost test. You require to use the software that's not useful.
The question was, have I answered? I think you're saying I haven't really answered the question.
Should you negate those scores in that column?
Yes, that's exactly the point.
Oh, I see what you mean. Okay, so the point is that if boost test has so many problems, then should I not take that thing and literally invert the score? I would answer that by saying that, in my personal opinion, I think boost test is a fantastic unit test library. I think it's hugely feature complete. It has loads and loads of really good stuff in it. I think it's got itself a very bad name. I think the bad name came about because it hugely increases compile times because they've defined it as header only by default. If they turned off that and they made it, you know, a linked library, it's a lot quicker to use. I think that it is a bit clunky. But that doesn't mean that it isn't very powerful. And I would still strongly recommend anyone that they should very strongly consider boost test amongst the available options, even though it has bugs, even though it has all the other issues that it has. So that's maybe answering your question. Beeman.
Yeah, I mean, the real requirement here is that that there are a set of tests for the library, and that set of tests integrates well with the testing framework that the release managers are using to boost. And so it doesn't it doesn't have to be boost.test. It can be a roll your own, or it can be a lightweight test, which I and Peter Dumont and a lot of other authors use. But those are all solutions that meet the requirements for our current testing framework.
Sure, so the point...
We may change that in the future and a different set of requirements.
Sure, the comment was that there are many ways of meeting the requirements of boost for unit testing, and perhaps you're saying that my interpretation is overly strict. I would agree that I've been anal about it, you know. So absolutely, there's a lot of debate to be had there. For example, you could get catched output XML, which fits exactly in with boost test and is therefore a perfect substitute. I think you can even get Google test to do with a bit of XSLT programming to transform the XML. So there's lots of options there. I think what I'm trying to get at really is that static assert and assert, and that's the only option you've got available to you, is not very release manager friendly. Whereas all you could do is you could create a macro framework, which when you flip a switch, will do the boost test type stuff, and then you can flip it back again to doing static assert and assert. And I think that would be nice, you know. Okay, I'll move on. The other thing there is that are there boost-ready docs? Now, this is such a subjective thing. It's entirely down to the person who looks at the documentation and decides, is it good or bad? For example, Louis may be a bit upset that I only gave him a 0.6. I should explain that. It's something about Do you know what it is? It's entirely a personal thing. I read through the documentation, and do I now understand the library? And most of it's my fault, not yours. That's genuine truth. But if I'm giving one to something, it's because I read it and I now get it. So I think a lot of that's my limitation rather than yours. So that's just to explain so you know where I was coming from with that. but I would say that there are other libraries like Expect. And I mean, Expected literally has one page of QuickBook. That's it. I mean, that's not documentation. So you can't really say anything about the library from its documentation. Boost ready build, most of these libraries are header only, which is fair enough. Louis?
Without derailing the talk, I would like to maybe poll the audience as to how important is it to have a documentation that's written using like a cookbook or the boost book or the usual tools? How important is it?
Well, the question was, he was going to ask the community, the room, how important is it that the documentation be written in BoostBook or QuickBook? I would answer back that that's probably not here's the good form for that. I would imagine that would be an excellent form to probably, I think that will come up during your library's review in a big way, and I think hopefully we'll get some consensus as to what to do moving forwards. So is it all right if I press on here rather than we move into that? All right, thanks. here's an interesting thing. These sections here are about using Travis and Ivory for per commit testing. This is for using Valgrind memcheck as part of the unit test to see if your compiler or your code is doing something funky with memory. And the last one here is coveralls. Coveralls is a really nice service. It's a web service that you can push line coverage. So you can integrate Travis, such as when Travis runs per commit, it will go off and do a set of unit tests, head click coverage of all of your lines, and then push them to coveralls, and coveralls will come back to a pull request and say, this pull request passed on Windows, passed on Linux, and also code coverage of unit tests has gone up or gone down. It's all free, and we really should be using a lot more of it because it's easy to integrate, it just needs to be done, and you have all this fancy tooling for free. So that's how I ranked them, and I ranked, by the way, to put them into order, I put them in the case of, are they in the peer review queue? In which case, they go at the top. And then after that, I ranked them on the basis of overall quality. That's where I was coming from with the ranking. So, as I say, I looked at 15 libraries. I excluded 5, and I'll just explain why. I had a look at there at Proto, Range, and Spirit. I took, again, an entirely personal viewpoint that they don't seem to be approaching a boost peer review yet, I felt. I may be wrong. I just looked at the source code, GitHub, the commits that were coming in, and that was my assessment. So that's why I excluded them. I excluded Hannah, Click and Fit because their authors are presenting at this conference. In fact, I think their authors are in this room for the most part. So I wasn't going to badly duplicate stuff that they're already talking about at this conference. There's no point. SIMD and Dispatch, I talked to its author and they said that the C++14 basically implements the 98 version with faster compile times. So there's no real huge improvement. So that's why we got 10 libraries coming out. That's where the methodology came in. And the reversal of the order is now purely me being contentious. Any questions at this point? All makes sense? All right. So first library. This is APIBind. I should add that it's still called bindlib at the time of writing because this conference has killed me in terms of preparation and time. And also GSoC's currently on, so that basically sucked up the time. It's the first thing I'm going to do as soon as I get off this conference is I'm going to go and do this along with a whole lot of other things I've been pushing till later. So what does APIBind do? APIBind is kind of a very odd library. I came up with it originally because I had a problem with AFIO. I had this library that was tied deeply into Boost that made a lot of use of Boost libraries, but it was a C++11 library. And all of the Boost facilities could just as easily be swapped out for STL facilities. And I was sitting there thinking to myself, I'd really like to do what ASIO does. So if you ever look at ASIO's implementation, you have the ability to select using macros whether ASIO uses Boost or uses STL11. And you can configure it any way you want. You can sort of have date time coming from Boost mixed with thread from STL11, mixed with exception states from Boost, right? Things like this, all sorts of weird combinations. And he's got this huge thing in his config.hpp, where he's just got massive macro logic that goes off and detects compiler versions and sort of chooses sensible defaults, and you can come in from the outside. And I was wanting to replicate exactly that system, but I didn't really want to type out a huge file of really complicated macro logic. So I wanted something that was automatable, something that you could just run a script and it went. And that's how I started going down this route, which led me to some very interesting places. So what I would say is that fundamentally, the library is about making Boost and STL dependency injectable. What do I mean by dependency injectable? Dependency injection is something kind of more familiar to Web 2.0 people or .NET people. What you do is you allow the external user of a library to configure the dependencies that that library will use as its implementation from the outside. So on the outside, you can come along, and you'll see this later on. I say, I want to use Boost file system, and I want to mix it with STL 11 thread. And internally, the library will go off, put those dependencies in place, and you get a library that pops out using that particular outcome. AFIO does it, and so does AFIO now. Another thing it does is that while I was at it, I realized you could do library versioning of APIs and ABIs. This is using C++ 11 features. APIBind works in 98 at a minimal level, but it doesn't provide things like fancy stuff like versioning because the language facilities aren't there. Another interesting thing you can do is you can do hard API version binds. So you can say that my library wants to use AFIO version 1. Your library can say, I want to use AFIO version 2. Let's say all these libraries are header only, and someone goes and includes my library and your library, and that will pull in two copies of AFIO, version 1 and version 2, and all of them will coexist in the same translation unit and just work. So that's what I mean by hard version binds. You can say, I want this specific version of a library, and somebody else can say a different version of the library, and it works. This is new. Boost could implement that, and indeed some libraries have versions, but getting them to coexist in the same translation unit is a lot of work under O3, and is a lot easier under C++ 11. So this is the thing. It's basically a toolkit for explicitly specifying dependencies between libraries, which is interesting because Beeman.
Just a question. The reason that it's a lot easier under 11 is inline namespaces, or are there other aspects of 11?
The question was, is it easier because of inline namespaces, or are there other aspects of 11? I will answer that in detail during the next 40 minutes, so you'll actually be walked through exactly what it is. What this allows is when you can formally specify dependencies, when you can formally specify versions, and you can explicitly lay out these bindings, this makes modular Boost workable, finally. You can go and download a specific Boost library. It will go off and fetch its individual dependencies. Those dependencies can have a different version and be of a different internal version than other dependencies with other versions. So you can actually combine modular Boost libraries with this system. So what's the requirements? No Boost dependencies, fairly obviously. Minimum compiler, 98. Maximum compiler for all of the maximum features. It requires a minimum of Clang 3.2, GCC 4.7, or Visual Studio 2013 with an asterisk. And that's that you probably can't read this, but Visual Studio 2013 doesn't have inline namespaces, and therefore we can't do API ABI versioning because the compiler is not up to 2015 works fine. So that's good. So what parts are there in API bind? What bits are mixed together to create such a thing? Firstly, you have the world's smallest emulation of Boost. You have Boost config, and you have Boost test, unit test. That's literally the only two libraries you currently get. I'm sure that in the future you'll have more, but if you want to do an absolute minimal port of a Boost library to STL11, it's really handy not have to run through and replace every single Boost no except with no except or some other internal library. So this thing just replicates all of the Boost macros with sensible defaults for C++ 11 compilers. Boost test unit test is actually the catch C++ framework wrapped up to pretend that it is the Boost test framework. So the way that that works is that you have the same macros and you do the same tests. I had to go and patch in thread safety into catch because catch is not a unit, not a thread safe framework. So I hacked in an almighty nasty evil. I do so much undefined behavior to get that to work that you don't really want to know. I had to do an awful thing with IO streams to make it to function because that's the trouble is he's writing out via IO streams into a string buffer, which then gets dumped out as part of the console thing. And if you have multiple threads doing it, you're just going into IO streams from multiple threads and you're corrupting all over the place. So I managed to patch in a mutex to make that happen. Anyway, I won't bore you with the details. I've sent in the patch request and I said, please just make your library, you know, thread safe, and then I won't have to do any of this stuff. Either way, it works, and I've verified under Valgrind and Thread Sanitizer that it's definitely thread safe. So And UBSAN's also run over the same code, and it's also safe from that perspective. CPP feature.h. It's kind of interesting because SG10 is coming up with a whole load of compiler feature macros for 17. And what you really want is that if you're using some compiler like GCC 4.5, you want a complete set of these macros all correctly defined what they're supposed to be. So GCC has some support for these macros built into the compiler. Clang has more support for those macros. Microsoft's compiler has no support for them, and Gabby has told me he will never allow those macros into his compiler as long as he can cope with it. So what this does, this header, is it basically goes through all the different compilers and it stamps out a set of macros which are correct. And the reason why that's useful is because boost config emulation then uses the SG10 compiler features to emulate the boost config options. So that's why that works the way it does. There's an import.h, and this is some preprocessor metaprogramming macros to basically generate all of the boilerplate for you. So you just go off and use them. You don't need to know how that works. Right, so what else comes with is an incomplete set of binds for the libraries. So I stress the incomplete, and it's mainly because the tooling is more of a proof that it works rather than anything which I would recommend to use. But surprisingly enough, it works really, really well. And I took the C++11 header files, all of these, which are the full set, and they can bind to either the STL or to boost. So I'll show you how that all works later on in this slide. I've even come out with some binds for file system and networking. They have a bit of a more weirder choice because Dinkumware ships a copy of file system in VS 2015. GCC5 now ships a copy too, but I haven't got around to updating it yet to support it, but it will be able to bind to Dinkumware or GCC 5. It can bind to boost, obviously enough, and for networking, it can bind to standalone ASIO, which is Chris's reference networking TS implementation. So you can configure standalone ASIO to be the networking TS, and it will bind to that as well. So basically, these bind files that you switch from the outside between boost or STL11 or ASIO as the case may be, so you just have one programming interface in your code, and you just go ahead and use it, and you don't worry about the dependency injection, because outside they're going to inject some implementation which, surprisingly, tends to work, actually. The other part is there's a Python script, and that just generates a whole lot of macro boilerplate for you, so you don't have to. And that lets you do ABI signature generation. I'll show you exactly how that works later on, too. And finally, you may be wondering how those bind files were made. They were made by using a libclang AST parsing tool. And what it does is you feed it header files, and it will spit you out a whole lot of binds, and they're template aliases. So they'll go off and they'll import some external namespace, a portion of external namespace, so a legacy monolithic namespace like namespace boost or namespace std, and you can bind individual parts of it as a separate modular component. And if you're a library that's in its own namespace, you don't need this at all. This is purely for breaking up legacy boost into parts or breaking up legacy std into parts. So someone said to me that it couldn't be done, and I said, I'm pretty sure it can, and I wrote it and went, ooh, this is a nasty piece of code, but it works. Okay, so I'm going to explain how API bind works. Does anyone have any questions so far? Ahmed.
So I'm kind of curious. I don't really see the motivation for wanting to do this if you have a C++11 or C++14 library anyway. Like, if you're using C++11 or 14 features, why would you want to be able to use these facilities rather than just relying on standard ones anyway?
So the question was, why would a C++11/14 library be interested in any of this? Because it already has the facilities available in the STL.
I mean, of course you can support broken implementations, but, well, like, other than that.
Well, I can give you the answer to this. The reason why is because imagine the future world, right? So we're talking 5 years from now. And let's just imagine that Vicente has gone off and rewritten Boost Thread, which he's planning to do, into this new, much, much superior version, which is going to extend out to the STL11 in all sorts of really fun, interesting ways. So brand new threading facilities, really exciting stuff. And let's say your library is currently using STL11, right? And you're looking at Boost Thread, brand new, reinvigorated, all C++11, fantastic version, and you'd really like to support it. But equally, you don't want to break modular standalone downloadability for the STL11 people. So the people who don't want the Boost fancy features may just want to download their library and get used to it. So this is a system for the future for letting you write up your library that can use fancy new boost thread or the existing threading library, and the user can select from the outside. Does that make sense?
It's not just the future. So, for example, in our code base, we can't use std shared pointer because it's thread safe, and the penalty for performance of being thread safe is unacceptable. So we still have to use a shared pointer that it's threaded code, but we have to use a not thread safe shared pointer that we guarantee we won't pass across a thread boundary to get the performance we want. Here, I could now use a library that, instead of using std shared pointer, I could inject my own shared pointer because I promise that it won't be used across threads, and I get the performance I want out of the library. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to use it because it would be too slow.
All right, the point that was made was that he is keen on the idea of being able to inject an arbitrary shared pointer implementation from the outside because his use case for shared pointer doesn't require threading safety, and therefore he could inject a non-thread safe version of a shared pointer in order to speed up his code. Is that more or less it? I have opinions on that. I won't bother actually answering them. I'll say that the future C++ standard STL, I think, is going to address your needs. So that's all I'll say about that. Alistair.
I want to make another example with shared pointer that comes basically from the standards committee, who are very grateful that Peter Dimov is continuing to press forward on new features that he's testing out in Boost shared pointer that can then be promoted into the standard once we've shaken out the experience in Boost. So the Boost shared pointer will frequently be more advanced than the standard shared pointer, and the standard committee very much appreciate that because we get the testing. And if your Boost library wants to depend upon the new features that Peter is introducing, you will want to be able to have that binding.
So the comment was that Peter Dimov has been pushing ahead Boost standard pointer with a whole lot of new extra features that the committee is very interested in, because these are all stuff that can come into a standard at a future stage. And the fact that you can dependency inject arbitrary shared pointer into instances might be very valuable for testing out the new features versus falling back onto the STL. I would comment on that makes a later slide in this wrong. So I did not know this before, so you've just created a typo and errata for me, but thanks for the point. Oh well. Are there any other questions? Beaven.
It's very much a corner usage, but it's important to the implementers of any of these libraries is that we all want to run our test suites against the other guy's implementation. Because the definitions of a defect in the standard is that sensible people reading it come to, and presumably the implementers are sensible people, come to different conclusions and write different code, and we want to know that. And so we do the same, I have done the same thing for clients many, many times, where you're running against different compilers and different environments purely to try to find problems. Mm-hmm. And so there may be details of this that I might want to argue about how it's done, but I think there's quite a bit of motivation here.
The comment was that a lot...
Transition, too. Transition motivation is important.
The comment was that one of the big reasons why we bother making portable code and testing it on multiple compilers and multiple tool sets is to figure out the deviations in the standard and quality and implementation of various facilities. And if we had the ability to dependency inject this stuff even within a single compiler tool set, then that could indeed be valuable. Is that about right?
That's right.
Okay. All right, I'll push on and then you can see how it works. Yeah? All right. Okay, so obviously, as I've mentioned, there is a bit of macro work here because, unfortunately, there's not a lot that we can do about that. So firstly, you need to imagine to yourself, you have this macro, and it's called namespace, and it takes some signature, which I will explain in the next slide. There is a namespace begin, which also takes the same signature that you just had before. Namespace end, again, the same signature as before. You also have this macro, which is an include an STL11, and you have an include an STL1Z, and that takes a prefix, which is a directory prefix, an implementation, so what's the actual implementation that you want the bind to and what kind of library you want. You might remember I listed out a series of bind files. This is basically the thing that goes and brings in a bind file, depending on 11 or 1z. And you'll begin to see how these work later on. So here's a signature. I've used literally code that is actually being used, so I have pulled that one out. As you see, the signature consists of boost in brackets, comma, AFIO in brackets, comma, V1, comma, inline in brackets. What happens with the macro processing is that the macro processing will look at the compiler and it says, do you support inline namespaces? And if you don't, it will make this one magically vanish completely. So that's what the macro preprocessing does. So it'll simply spit out boost AFIO. If it's on a compiler that does support it, then you do get inline popping out here as you're supposed to. And then what you do is you define boost AFIO version namespace, and that's defined to the earlier macro you saw beforehand with the signature. Here it is, boost the namespace again, same thing again with the signature, and there's namespace end this, right? So what you've done is you've set out a set of templates for your particular library, customized with your particular signature, and you'll now probably guess what comes next. So imagine to yourself, in a traditional library, you're going to have namespace boost, namespace AFIO, struct foo, okay? So that's how you're defining your stuff in your header, and when you're going off and using it, you're going to go boost AFIO foo. Dead simple, traditional. All you're going to do is you're going to replace this namespace part up here with boost AFIO v1 namespace begin. Struct foo goes to struct foo. There's your namespace end, and then if you want to qualify it, you now precede it with a macro. Okay? So far, so good. Easy enough. All right. You'll see what that goes and takes you soon. So just to give, really emphasize what I'm proposing here, I'm saying that the minute you go off and you tend to use a library like boost AFIO directly. So you'll go off and you go boost dot dot AFIO dot dot, whatever it is you want to use. It's very important to this technique, you don't do that anymore. What instead you do is you namespace alias into your local library, AFIO to be pointing to this, right? Because of inline namespacing, that always means latest AFIO. That's defined what that is to be. If you don't want that to be the case, you will postpend a V1 here, or a V2, or a V3, or whatever else, or you'll use the macro, which is even better again for reasons that I'll explain shortly. So what's happening here is the inline namespace hides the real namespace, which is the V1, and therefore latest version always appears as if it's at AFIO. So earlier on I said that you can bind to a specific version of a library. This is how you do it. Instead of writing what I just wrote earlier on, you now replace the header file would say you're incorporating the V1 header file because that will include the V1 implementation. And then you're now aliasing into AFIO the V1 namespace. So now you've bound your library specifically to version 1, and other libraries can bind to any other version of your library. You've hard bound it into your library. Just in case it hasn't made complete sense, imagine in the future things. So your libraries are growing and you're making ABI breaks, and you're expanding the feature set. What that means is, in practice, is that you're going to have namespace boost AFIO. Legacies are going to go live inside a fixed namespace, V1, and then latest is always going to live inside an inline namespace, whichever it is, it could be V2, V3, V4, whatever. So library A uses V1, works. Library B uses AFIO V2, works, because they're living in totally different namespaces. If I use unqualified AFIO, I get latest. If I want specifically version 1, I ask for version 1. It's really, really simple. There's no magic whatsoever in this. Any questions? Everyone understands? Good, 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 good. Okay, so now, oh, Beeman, go on.
I'll just make a comment that that is, I believe that the underlying scheme there is the same underlying scheme that the C++ committee is using for versioning its TS libraries. Mm-hmm. Now, so you're providing all sorts of ways to use that in more sophisticated ways to present it to the users. But the actual V1, V2, namespace, the inline, that's the same scheme that's going to be in the TSs as they ship.
So the comment was that it is believed that the TSs coming out of the standard uses exactly the same technique of versioning and then using inline versioning to map a particular version is into being latest. Alistair?
So I'll be looking slightly queringly. There is a second scheme we use for inline namespaces in the TSs
if the expected library will land directly in the STD namespace as opposed to a namespace of its own. So if we're going to land in STD rather than, say, STD chrono, we'd be having an inline version, inline namespace just for the TS with an underscore version in it. But with respect to what this library is trying to achieve, the second one we use is not relevant. So
yeah,
I'm noise for those who want to particularly care about dotting I's and crossing T's as to how it relates to the standard. But yeah, this is...
So the comment was lots of interesting stuff about how the STL is implemented by the committee, which I won't bother repeating back.
Okay, although you are pushing a lot... Can you go back one slide? You are pushing a bunch back onto your users here. They're going to get some really, really strange error messages if you call something in file A and then get something back and try to pass it into a routine in file B. You're going to get no matching overload or can't convert a boost AFIO underscore V1 blah, 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 to boost AFIO underscore V2, same thing. And there's an education thing that has to happen there.
The point was made that when you segment off libraries in this way, that if you pass a structure coming out of one and you feed it into the other, that you're going to get things like overload resolution failing, that things not found, and that there is an education level that's required to get people up to thinking in that sense. I would add to that as well, there's nothing stopping people writing some metaprogramming that will automatically move stuff between A and B in a transparent fashion. So versions, there's a common framework. And myself and Vicente have been looking into something that will compose futures when the futures are heterogeneous, as in completely different future types from completely different implementations. And it kind of relates to all of that. Any other questions? Okay, we'll move on. So here's the dependency injection part and how it works. So here's the problem. What if your library would like to use boost thread or the STL11 thread? What happens if it would like to choose between file system and file system TS? What happens between ASIO and networking TS? And just to really rarefy exactly what I mean by this, what if header-only library A is dependent on V1, configured with boost thread, file system, and boost ASIO, but same header-only B, also in the same translation unit, requires boost AFO same version, but configured with thread, file system, and networking from a completely different source? How do these two work in the same translation unit without running into each other? I'm going to argue, and I'm going to claim because I don't know, but I reckon this is going to be highly likely in future boost libraries because as I mentioned to Ahmed earlier on, if you have fancy new boost thread and people want to make that possible, you're going to have the trouble that some libraries in the same translation unit will use old STL11, but there'll also be other libraries using fancy new boost thread. Only ASIO and AFO currently let you do this dependency injection. I think AFI is the only one that lets the dependency injection work within the same translation unit. So ASIO basically says, if you configure me this way, I refuse to allow another copy of myself to be also inside the same translation unit, which is a very sensible and default thing to do. I've had a crack at going a bit better, and I can prove it works because I have unit testing that goes off and configures multiple versions of AFIO, binds them onto the same translation unit, and runs unit tests on the entire lot of them, and it works, it passes. So far, out of the five libraries currently in the boost review queue, three use STL11 and only one uses boost, and you can probably see that this is going to be potentially a problem in the future. So how do you do the configuration? The way that I settled on is that you have these external macros set by the person who's using AFIO. So if I want AFIO to use boost thread, I set this to 1. If I want it to use boost file system, I set this to 1. If I want ASIO standalone, the reason why it's ASIO standalone is not the same as the others is because ASIO has its own macro, and ASIO standalone can't coexist with itself in a different configuration. So I had to use their macro, which makes sense. What happens then is your config HPPP goes off and it takes these values and it converts them into a string implementation. So these macros get set to either std or boost for each of those different items. Okay? Here's where it begins to get a bit more mind-bendy. So now, you remember that the signature that I went and mentioned earlier on was nice and simple, boost AFIO V1 inline, yeah? Well, now, you have to imagine that instead of having the version 1 inline, which is nice and short. You're now going to use bind lib namespace version. Here's your version 1. But now you're including STL11 implementation, file system implementation, and ASIO implementation off the earlier thing. And what that will go and do is it will go and synthesize an inline namespace, which is unique to version 1, this, this, and this. So you get a different inline namespace every single time for every single one of the configurations. So having done all that, you now come along and you say to yourself, well, I don't want to type out every single possible combination of all of those macros, because even with 3 macros, you now have 8 different configurations that you can build a library with. So I wrote a Python script, and you feed it the macros you want to do. And this Python script will simply spit out all of this lovely boilerplate. So what happens is it firstly undefines this macro at the top. This is the header control guard macro at the beginning, which controls whether the header file for AFIO gets included or not. So you simply unset that, and you will run this every time the AFIO header gets included. You then go off and you simply go, if not this, and not this, and not this, then define this, and then define, yes, I do need to include. What you're doing here is you're doing a header guard for this particular combination of those macros. You now move on to this, and you find that this is now true, and this is false, and this is false. And you'll see there's binary true, binary false, and this is now a header guard for that particular configuration. Right? And it just goes on. So for all 8 possible configurations, you have a header guard defined here, which defines this to be 1 if you need to re-include it. Otherwise, it prevents a re-inclusion of exactly the same stuff. Okay?
So how many libraries do you anticipate being dependent on? It gets pretty bad pretty fast, right?
The question was, how many libraries do you anticipate being dependent on? And it gets pretty bad pretty fast. And the addition was that if I have 16 or 20 dependencies, all of which can be chosen, then you know you've got 2 to the power of 16 or whatever different configurations. I would say that this system does not scale out very well, but it scales out probably good enough until C++ modules turns up. So that would be my answer to that. I would just love if we didn't have to use macros for this stuff, but my only alternative is a build system that understands when to do this stuff separately, and we need to decide on a build system for that first, you know, that we're going to go use. So that would be the answer to that. Okay, next step is pretty straightforward. Remove your old-fashioned header guards. So instead of doing in fndef, doing this, that goes away. You now have instead include your config, and notice the fact that it is an unguarded include. So every time you include the header file, you're always including config. And what happens now is that config will have set this to either on or off. And if it is on, then you go off and you include it. And because this has been reconfigured by config, and that has been reconfigured by config, and all of the internal dependency injections have been reconfigured by config. So you go off and you include the same header with different configuration, and you get a new thing stamped out.
Now?
Yep, sure.
Does that impact on compile times for compilers that look for the header guard idioms?
Does that affect compilers that look for the header guard idioms? I have not tested the answer to that. I believe that one of the compilers is clever enough that it may, under precompiled headers, get it right. But that is a suspicion that is completely unfounded by empirical testing. I would imagine that there will be... I haven't noticed a massive amount of slowdown in the compilation time, but then I am using precompiled headers for my unit tests, and I think that makes a lot of this complexity go away. I think it would be really interesting to find out, for sure. Any other questions? Okay, it's actually 12 o'clock already, amazing enough. So, obviously, this is all really ugly and nasty, dirty. Nobody likes using macros to generate multiple ABI versions. But what's it like for the users from the outside? Because that's, in the end, what we really care about. So this is actually code, literally pulled from the unit test, which tests whether AFIO in one configuration coexists with another and completely passes. So I literally pulled this. And as you can see, you configure thread off, boost thread off, file system on, and ASIO standalone on, and you include the test all, which goes off and pulls in a full copy of the unit tests and all the headers in that particular configuration. You then undef that previous set of configurations. You now configure boost thread on, boost file system on. You leave off ASIO standalone because ASIO standalone, according to ASIO, must be undefined if you don't want the standalone to happen. You re-include test all.cpp, and it simply pulls in a second copy. So that's what it's like for the users to use. It's literally as simple as you can imagine. It just works. Now, I will grant you, the compile time goes up enormously. To put it mildly, I mean, it goes from less than a minute for everything up to about 6 minutes. So the poor old compiler goes, ugh, because it's having to go off and pull in huge numbers of dependencies. Again, C++ modules makes a lot of this go away. So this is the thing. It looks all messy and dirty and full of problems. I personally find it just works. All the C++, sorry, the config HPP stuff is basically templated and fire and forget installable. It's just boilerplate, easy to put in. We've scripts to do it. The only thing I've noticed in testing when I've been using it is that it is quite easy to break multi-ABI. So you go off and you make a change to your code and you'll suddenly find that you've broken the multi-version dependency, because in the end you're shipping multiple ABIs of your library. So the same way as if you do that, you're always going to find it a bit brittle. If you can accidentally leak out a symbol, they'll collide and then you'll get a compile error. This is all stuff that unit testing is perfect for. So every per commit, it goes off, it does a whole lot of testing, and it simply comes back, you've broken your library, you fix it, it's great. And the great thing is, this stuff is much, much simpler than ASIO's method. ASIO is this enormous file, very complicated to get right. I mean, there's been bugs filed against it because the macro logic is so complicated that Chris has made a few mistakes from time to time, and people will file a thing saying this doesn't work, you know, clang combined with such and such configuration breaks, and you have to go in and make another change to it. That doesn't happen with this solution, which is useful. I'll just quickly explain how binds modularize, how the bind files work. Sorry.
I was just wondering if Chris Wolfhoff, I assume that you and him have talked and he's sort of aware of what you're doing, and do you know if he has any plan to adopt this?
The question is that surely I and Chris have been in communication, and is he aware of this, and does he have any plans to adopt any of this? Myself and Chris have been in communication, but nothing to do with any of this. And I don't believe he is aware of any of it. And would he adopt it? I guess you just have to ask him. It would be interesting to know. I think certainly he's got a script that converts standalone ASIO into boost ASIO, so it basically runs through and automatically replaces all this stuff. I think that automated system works well with what he's got, which is why he's chosen the way he has. Beeman.
Big as that, as ASIO, into C++ is going to, he's not thinking about much of anything else, right?
I'm not sure I'm going to repeat back that comment necessarily publicly.
Settle it is, Chris is really busy right now.
He's really busy, yeah.
Sure. The comment is that Chris is really busy right now. Yes, he is. He's been very good at fixing patches and stuff, but he's very much focused on getting his vision of ASIO into the standard complete, right?
And that's, you know, what the standard committee wants him to be focused on. And I'm sure I can't speak to the committee, but most members would agree with that.
Sure. The comment was that they do want Chris working hard to get it into the standard. I'll only add my own quick comment to that, because obviously it's not germane to the current discussions, but I've noticed that the committee started chopping off certain bits of functionality in ASIO to get it to fit into the standard, and some of those choices I think are highly regrettable. I think there's other areas of ASIO which definitely need to be chopped. I really would wish that someone who is a real expert in ASIO was the person who's doing the chopping, because the bits like the event loop and the generic reactor infrastructure should all definitely enter into C++, because it gives you the Qt event loop compatibility, it gives you a long list of other stuff, but this is something, you know, that is a debate not probably important for right now.
I know exactly what you're talking about, and I agree with you.
Oh, okay. We agree was the outcome. That's fantastic. All right, I'll quickly explain how bind files work, because this is where the Clang AST tool comes in. And we're actually beginning to run a bit low on time, so I think I'll probably have to jump to the end after API bind is done, which is exactly what I expected was going to happen. You may remember this slide from earlier on where I forgot to color code this one. Never mind. These are the bind files, so I've basically got all of them. And the question is how do these bind files get generated, and what are they even? So they're very simple. What you do is you take your header file, and you feed it to the tool that I've written, which is a very nasty tool, but it works. And it goes off and it applies a regex, which is why it needs GCC 4.9 or better, to calculate the binds. What's currently supported? Types and functions, template types, including template templates and template functions. Enums, scoped, and cform are supported. And what's currently missing is default template args, because I simply haven't got around to it yet. Variable and template variables. The variables is really annoying because there's some stuff that you could really do with having with that, but it requires a whole new code path. It just needs to be, again, sat down and done. So this was good enough, you see, for my purposes. I need to do more. Apart from the default template args, I really could do with actually having that. So here's what a bind file looks like, and I'm really glad we're in Hudson, because you're all close enough to be able to read the tiny, tiny, tiny writing. So imagine to yourself the ratio header file that comes with C++, right? And it's going to go into find, named place stood, template, int max for the numerator and denominator. And you notice there's a default parameter there for class ratio. So that's the interface specification for ratio. What we do is we go and take the Clang tool and we feed it. This is the output file, bind stl11 std ratio. And we are putting this macro prefix before it. Over here is the regular expression, which is std. So don't map anything with a leading underscore, because libstandard C++ likes to put lots of leading underscores for things that you don't want to have exposed. And then here, don't use anything with a colon. So what you're saying is you only want something with a single item. You don't want any internal namespaces to be output. You then put ratio, because that's the C++ header, standard header. You now compare it against the boost header, which is the specification here, and the boost ratio. So what the tool is going off and doing is it takes and loads in a copy of the standard ratio header file. It then loads in the boost ratio header file. And then it compares all of the type signatures between the two according to the regular expression. And it only outputs the ones which are completely common between the two, right? And the reason why this is important is because you want to be able to swap between boost and the STL with complete semantic equivalence. So it only outputs the things which are common, which is actually a surprisingly large amount, including class ratio. What happens then is that the bind that's generated by the tool, and this is a reduced form because it's quite verbose, it firstly goes and puts in this macro, which is STL ratio map namespace begin. This is defined by code which includes the bind to say which namespace I would like to bind the bind into. Here's the thing that lets you temporarily disable it if you really don't want ratio to come in for whatever reason. And down here is a template alias, which simply goes template int max using ratio equals std ratio with exactly the same parameters. You'll notice the fact that there's no default parameter here, like there should be, because the tool currently doesn't support that, and it really needs to. So, and then it ends the namespace. So that's what a bind file is. It's just a ton load of these things binding part of some big monolithic namespace into some namespace that's been defined externally by this macro. Does this make sense? Yeah? Okay. Kind of wrecked my head, so. Okay, so this is how your config.hpp brings in the bind file. Firstly, you saw earlier on, this is the namespace you need to define for the bind file to work, and we're simply going to define it as namespace mylib. You also have to define the end, because maybe it's not mylib, it might be mylib detail, or mylib ratio, or mylib stl11 or something. If you now want to bind std ratio into namespace mylib, you call this macro, which expands out the location of the bind file to load in, bind lib with std with ratio. So therefore, all of your things are going to be mapped to std ratio. If you wanted boost ratio instead, you can include exactly the same thing, but instead of having std, you're now using boost, and it will go off and pull in the appropriate bind file that binds all of your ratios within namespace mylib to boost ratio instead. So this is how you swap between the two. It expands into these, as you see, and that's what happens effectively. So namespace mylib turns into, because of the include, the earlier thing that we saw earlier, the template alias. So fairly straightforward.
So I've gotten a little lost in the macro implementation versus example. So can you have a third namespace here, like my boost or my lotlib? Or does the library actually have to bake in the number of options beforehand? So can I have a third namespace and bind that instead?
You're saying, the question is are the options available to library end users baked in, or can someone choose an arbitrary thing to insert? Is that correct?
Yeah.
The answer to that is that under this system, it is only what the library maintainer gives you the options of. And I'll tell you the simple reason why. It's because when you're unit testing every single possible combination of these things, you're only going to supply a library that you're saying, I hand on heart, and I say that I think this will probably work with all of these different combinations. If I allow external users to come in and start supplying their own stuff, then you can't really give any quality guarantees. That's not to say that you can't come along and modify your own config.hpp and get it to do anything you want, you know?
Right, or do something even more horrible, which you have your own boost namespace, or whatever else, what other horrors you do to that.
He's suggesting that you could do even more horrors, and I'm...
I'm just curious why it's dependency injection. Why not allow arbitrary dependency injection with the caveat that here's what I'm testing?
The question is why not allow arbitrary dependency injection? Because, is that basically it?
Yeah. With your quality concern saying, here's what I have tested.
Sure. So he's saying, why not allow dependency injection, arbitrary dependency injection, and then you then supply in the documentation that these following combinations are the ones that I've tested. I think that's entirely possible for the future. I personally find that a bit worrying from, you know, Boost is meant to be about quality, and it's about testing, and I think the library maintainer needs to have control over, I mean, sometimes you need special code paths. For example, Boost file system at the minute isn't quite the same as Boost the file system TS. There's a few small changes. So I, unfortunately, have to have little bits of code sometimes that goes in there, especially with the use of class enums, that says, am I binding to Boost file system, in which case I'll do this slightly different code path because I don't have any class enums. Otherwise, I use the file system TS. And when Beamer gets around to updating Boost file system, I'll simply eliminate that code. We'll have all of the through. So that's why I would say...
Well, but on the flip side, Boost range will work with iterators for my custom container, and if I don't implement my iterators correctly, Boost range breaks. That's kind of the same thing.
So the comment was that Boost range works with your iterators, and if you supply different iterators, that Boost range doesn't break?
No. My point is, if my iterators are broken, so that's the dependency injection. If my iterators are broken, then Boost range is not going to work as expected. Because I violated the iterator concept that I promised, or whatever the case may be.
So the comment was that if you supply broken iterators to Boost range, then if you get undefined behavior or other breakage, that's really on you, yeah?
Right. Same thing.
Sure, but all I would say is what I proposed is it could easily be modified. Yeah. Is it all right if I move on, because time's getting a little short? All right. Okay, so here's what we have. I suggested earlier on, if you remember, to use template aliasing to bind your imports into a local item. So what you do is, obviously, once you've brought in the bind, so you're now doing using ratio equals stud ratio, you should no longer fully qualify your ratio with a stud. You simply use ratio, use it naked. And that way, then it'll symlink to whichever implementation of ratio you've got. I'll quickly run through, yes. So this is basically what I've just gone and said, symbolic link. So you can basically take a dependency injection of part of a library and inject it in. Sorry, we're beginning to get a little low on time. I'll quickly run over my notes on me doing a port of my own library to my own system. It's a lot of work, to be absolutely honest. It's the same as porting your system to a brand new platform. You'll do an awful lot of regular expression find and replace. So you're going to find every single instance you did std ratio, and you're going to replace it with a ratio, and so on and so forth. And you just got to slog through it. There's a whole lot of refactoring. The good news is that you will formalize your dependencies explicitly for the very first time in your life, and this has big, big benefits. I will mention that I said don't use shared pointer for this technique, or is constructible. Good idea this. Would anyone like to hazard why I went and did this dependency, this difference? Anyone like to take a guess? No? Okay. The reason why is because earlier on, whoever mentioned it was, that you'll get a multiplication of dependency options. And if you have, say, three options, you've got eight different configurations. You need to be really parsimonious with what you're going to allow to be injected, because if you let it explode, it's just going to go crazy. So that's the reason why shared pointer looks like maybe that might be one to consider after all. But that's the reason why you have to be very parsimonious. Skip this. AFIO is about 8K line library, 18K lines in total, really small. Cool. It took me about 60 hours, but what I would say is because you formalize the dependencies, you get a whole lot of interesting bugs popping out that you never even knew they were there. I learned a whole lot of stuff, which I was really, really surprised. Specifying your dependencies is really good because it makes you reason about what are you doing, why are you doing it, do you need to be doing it. The trouble with C++ is it's just too easy to bring in something from some other library, one single line, which brings a full dependency on that library when you probably didn't really need that particular dependency. And I found that was really good. It made the code quality much, much better. I was really, really surprised about that. And basically, it's really easy to use. You just go off and you download a tarball and get to work. Enormous benefit. I myself now do all development on the standalone edition. I don't have to deal with boost build anymore. I just simply precompile the entire thing into C++ module, and I use a shell script with a single GCC instruction to do all my testing nowadays. So you run everything, and all unit tests fire off. I think it's a very valid vision for boost 2.0, personally. All right, we're going to go and skip through, because of lack of time, a whole load of stuff. So I was going to go and talk about AFIO. I was going to talk about fiber. And I was going to talk about DI. All I would say is DI is one that you should really go look at. It's a beautiful example of a library. I also went through what relevance each of them had to C++, the standardization efforts, and a long list of other things. You can also go off and, of course, go look at this separately with the slides afterwards. So are we there? OK. I promised some big picture answers. Two things. When I started this, so I said, you know, I was going to have a look at sweeping view of the wider picture of stuff, and I'm just going to actually wing it rather than reading my notes. So the question is which of these new libraries that I out of the 10 that I reviewed, which really require C++03 and which really require C++11? These are the ones that really, the API perspective, these could all be written in O3, to be absolutely honest, and the API from the external user would be pretty much the same. AFI only really needs R value reference API. If we didn't have them, we could do something a bit more CRA-like. Other than that, you're really talking, these could be O3 libraries, which is five of them, which is interesting. This 5.3, this three, on the other hand, couldn't have been done in C++03. HANA, just not possible. Not even possible without C++14. It already pushes C++14 implementations to the limit. Louis just informed me that he's probably going to require GCC 5.1 to get it working in GCC. So that's just how far it's going. Alistair. Louis would be the right person to answer that, and there is a very long list of stuff that it, I mean, he makes some crazy constexpr usage.
Constexpr, thank you.
Yeah, in a big way.
Extended constexpr, okay.
In fact, Louis, tell them.
I told you to do type generic numbers, generalized constexpr. I think that's basically.
And moreover, he needs them to work perfectly correctly.
Generic lambdas and constexpr, those are too good.
So the question was, well, what was the need for C++14? Expected. Really doesn't make any sense as a monadic transport type without C++11, because what's the point of having a monadic idiom anyway in C++03? It just is unusable. It doesn't do free copies. It doesn't do any of the other things. You really need unrestricted unions to make your life easy. You can emulate them, of course, but really also you need constexpr. Tick and fit, there are concepts and traits. You really would struggle to do that without constexpr in a useful fashion. So these are the three libraries that definitely would be needed. I went and looked at what kind of C++11 features were really commonly used. I found very interestingly that this list are almost every library is using, almost without question. These are only somewhat used, which is kind of interesting. I find it really odd that override and final is not used as much as it should be. There's actually a Clang tidy warning which will warn you when you're not using override on an overrided virtual function, which is fantastic.
Yeah, there's also a Clang-based tool that will go through your code base and it may have been folded into Clang tidy at this point that will add overrides in place.
Marshall pointed out that there is now a tool from Clang, probably in Clang tidy, that will go off and actually insert overrides where they're missing in your code base in order to modernize it. So that just goes,
right.
You know.
The tool is called Clang Modernize. It does a lot of other things too.
Absolutely. He was mentioning the tool is called Clang Modernize. I've never needed to use it myself, but I could certainly see in some of the employers I worked in it would be really, really useful to have. You're facing some of the code that you saw. Something that's interesting is that what's not very common in any of these libraries is these particular sets of features. The most obvious, I suppose, is variable templates. You're not going to see a lot of because Microsoft's compiler does not support them at all. And I think people have been avoiding them as a part of that. Kind of more interesting is people haven't been using inline namespaces as much as they should. And I'm surprised. I mean, alignment and new literals, you'd have thought you'd see more of. Alistair?
I'd say variable templates are also very new because they're 14, aren't we?
Oh, sure. As I said, the template variables are very new because they're 14 only, and you're absolutely correct.
The latest Clang and GCC only.
Yes, and as you mentioned, it's latest Clang and GCC only. Marshall, you?
I'm not really surprised that few people are using alignment because the alignment support is kind of optional in the standard. Compilers are free to not actually pay that much attention to it.
Marshall's pointing out that the alignment support in the current standard is something that compilers may optionally follow, more or less.
Or library vendors.
I would say that having worked with SSC vector types, I really would wish that the library did more respecting of that, because it makes life a lot easier if you do. I will say as well that external templates, I haven't seen them used once, which is kind of surprising, because reducing compile times would be really useful, but hey, you know. Something interesting out of the libraries I looked at, I mentioned this earlier on, cert and static cert is surprisingly common. They're not using boost test. Most don't use boost build, they prefer CMake, which is really interesting. I kind of think you'd guess if you looked at the list that this was going to be the case. And most don't have any boost dependencies at all. So I was asking up here, do these libraries take notice of one another and integrate well with other libraries, or are they ivory towers? You will not be surprised to learn they're pretty much all ivory towers. I would say that they look awfully like early DIY pre-Boost libraries. So before Boost ever turned up, every C++ library went off and did its own thing, reinvented the wheel again and again and again internally, and it looks awfully like it was before Boost ever came in. I'll just finish point before I talk to you. Interestingly, I went through all the libraries, and this is where I'm coming at from a rationale for a Boost 2.0 libraries, that a lot of these guys are reinventing concepts. There's an internal concepts implementation, there's an internal traits implementation. Some are really good, some are really bad. This is all stuff that is fantastic for a Boost 2.0, but none of it would work in the 1.5 series or 1.x series, because it all is very, very heavy C++11. So I suppose you could put it in and pack it as part of the distro, but equally a lot of these libraries will not want to pull in the entire Boost just to get this one particular part. So that's certainly an option. Louis?
I'd just like to mention that Anna does support, works with the MPL and the Fusion and the standard library. I try to, take into account that maybe users are coming from these libraries.
Louis points out that Hannah has actually quite a lot of integration with MPL, with Fusion, and with
Stdouble
and stuff. This is all after I last looked at Hannah, so this is news to me and I didn't previously know it. So thanks for that. How many of these libraries contribute to a future C++ standardization? The reason why I ask this question is people are worried, is Boost going to be relevant to C++ standardization in the future or not? And I'm purely basing this on having talked to the authors in question, that these libraries say yes. And as far as I'm aware, although I could be wrong, these libraries are not. So 5 yes, 5 no. I think that looks quite healthy. Are there techniques used in one library which would be really useful to use in another? I would say that the practice is highly uneven between these libraries, because not all authors know what best to do yet. So I went and wrote up a handbook of best practices in these libraries, and I'm going to go and have a link at the end. So I will just quickly flick through. This is the stuff that's in it, this is the stuff that's in it, and it's 19 points. Finally, and we're at the end with 5 minutes to spare. Sorry?
So that was really useful.
Sorry, I'll have the link at the end so you can go look it up yourself. But it's a wiki document on Boost, so you know it's a living document that will evolve. What's really interesting is a few years ago, Boost was looking a bit unhealthy. There'd be no new libraries that had gone into review or entered the library in quite some years. I think it was 2 at the time. What's happened since 2013 is we have 17 new libraries, 9 of which have passed review. I mean, Boost is extremely healthy now. I reckon, and this is my claim, that the 1114 libs look awfully like pre-Boost libs back before 1990s. And I personally believe there's an obvious rationale for C++ 11 only 2.0. And you can migrate those libraries out of the 1.5 series, and they can coexist. So they can live in the 1.5 series and in the 2 series as the maintainer so desires. And I think that it's not just, it makes it very highly wise that we have a modular, completely standalone, downloadable, and we don't repeat the mistakes we did with the monolithic. You have to bear in mind, mistake is the wrong word to use. Back when Dave and Beeman were starting all of this, they were looking for something that would create a standard library for C++ into the future. So it made sense to have a monolithic namespace and a monolithic build. And that kind of grew and grew and grew and grew. We don't have that anymore, because C++ 14.11 has got an excellent standard library now built into it. And also the new libraries coming to Boost are much more niche. They're much harder to get review consensus on. Oftentimes only about 4 or 5 people can usefully comment on a new library coming in. And that makes it much more reasonable to make it modular instead of making it monolithic. So that's my personal opinion. And that there is the link to the handbook, which hopefully you'll be able to read. Thank you very much for coming and listening. If there's any questions, you have as long as you want, really, 4 minutes and something. Anyone want to ask any questions? Sure.
You
mentioned something. Could you repeat what you had said about it? Maybe I misunderstood. I got the sense that you thought the boost expected did not make sense in a pre C11 environment, C11 environment.
The question was, I had made the statement or the claim that boost expected made no sense in a pre-11 environment. I obviously have some experience with boost expected because I used it quite a lot and I know Vicente well. expected is a great piece of engineering, but it's really big. It's a full monadic Haskell type implementation library. It does a ton load of stuff. I mean, you can do all sorts of cool things with it. The great trouble is once you start including it into a lot of files, your compile times go really far down, and that's its biggest limitation. But other than that, it's great, you know. How it works internally is it does a lot of helping the compiler to not generate any code at all. So if you come and you return from a return function, some type T, the compiler, most of the time, if it comes out and it has to look up the type T, it will completely eliminate all code completely, and it returns as if you returned the T directly without encapsulating it into expected. And there's a huge amount of machinery that's been put in there to make sure the compiler does the right thing most of the time. None of that could be done in O3. You'd have to encapsulate it into the thing, you'd have to then expand it back out again, and you'd have all of this overhead of extra copying, which in 11 again, you don't have to do any of that because you can often allied move construction and simply construct into place. That said, the return value optimization does make some of that possible. Sorry?
So I understand your perspective, that makes a lot of sense, and I would just like to say, even with the penalty, some people might find it of value simply because of the formalism it's providing, even though the performance hit is there.
The addition was that some people in O3 may well find that the formalism of having a monadic return type is worth even the extra speed penalty that happens. I will say that in answer to that, that I find that the case for using monadic return transport much more compelling in 11 than 03. It's even in 11, it's contentious, right? I mean, the committee has looked at monadic transport types and there's question marks over everything that they've seen so far. No clear winner has emerged because of various concerns about it. And that's in 11, 14. In 03, I think there'd be a lot more question marks over it given the cost benefits involved. That said, I do agree with you, and of course someone should really probably roll something that is really lightweight and simple, you know, for O3 code purposes. Are there any other questions? Okay, thank you very much.